Sarah Lavella, your first.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. How are you?
Good. And you?
Fine, thanks. You're Sarah?
Yes.
My name is Jonathan Edwards. I'm the chair of the board.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. You guys want to introduce yourselves?
Yeah, I'm Fred Roloski.
I'm Paul Moon.
Paul will be the chair of the board in
2 weeks.
Yeah, about 2 weeks, yeah.
We can move it up to today if you want to, Paul.
No, that's all right.
I think it's a little over a week.
Motion denied.
We are thrilled that you've been able to join us this morning. We are in the throes of replacing our town administrator, who was here for not long enough, but he was a good one. He put the town in very good shape, following a town administrator that had been here for quite some time. So ideally, we're looking to get back a little bit of continuity, but we're also looking for someone with a lot of energy, or at least I am. I won't speak for these guys. A lot of energy and a willingness to do whatever it takes to get the job done. So again, thank you very much for coming in. I guess I'll start off, and this is Mary Ellen Cranston, who you've met.
We've committed.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I already forgot your name, otherwise I'd introduce you.
Dan.
Dan, this is Dan. I guess I'll start it off and then throw it to one of these guys. I guess I'm curious what brings you to Whately.
I like small towns. I worked at the Hampshire Regional Planning Commission for some time, dealing with all sorts of communities out there. I'm from Southampton originally, which was a smaller town growing up than it is now. And I just enjoy it. I enjoy the politics. I enjoy the way things work. I like working in small towns.
Right. What do you think of Nate? He's a good guy. Isn't that his name?
Nat.
Yes. I call him Nate. I don't know why.
Yes. I like working with Nat.
Yeah. But what appeals to you about this particular position?
I like the area. I'm local. I live in Shelburne Falls. I have no plans to relocate anytime soon. I hope to remain here for the long term.
What do you got, guys?
What do you know about Whately?
We have some industry and farming. It's sort of an interesting mix. I don't know too much about Whately in particular. I know a lot about the area, but I would be happy to learn.
You know what we've been going through in the last year or two?
I know you moved your offices. That's a big change. Okay. There's some school department changes and building issues. But not specifically, though. I guess, which is maybe a good thing, not to come in with any prejudices or preconceived notions.
Okay.
I'd like to add to what Jonathan said about Mark's leaving and say that the primary reason Mark is leaving is because he got a position much closer to home.
So he was not interested in driving quite so far.
No, he drove from Great Barrington to here every day.
It's a long
day that he came here, and he has a young family, and so it's not like, you know, he left in a huff or there was some sort of personal problem along those lines, so you don't have to worry that you're jumping into a rat's nest or a lion's den or whatever the expression is.
That's good.
Yeah, in fact, I've been on the board for, I think, 4 terms, and usually the town operates very quietly and agreeably, except when Mark started the job, things got a little more interesting than usual. And there still is a level of interest that will keep you engaged, hopefully. And it's not bad, it's just interesting politically. We're dealing with several issues that need shepherding at this point. And we're not new into these issues. These issues have been long gone. And one is we're trying to fill this building with some occupants. And we're also trying to help facilitate the sustainability of our South County Emergency Medical Service, which is a 3-town cooperative effort, more or less cooperative. So there are some politics involved with that.
I followed that a little bit.
Okay, good.
So I do have some.
So that's a big deal. We'd like to get this building occupied, and there are other people that would also like to occupy this building, which we would entertain if need be. And the other issue, I guess, is some of the other more contentious issues have actually been resolved. So I don't think you're should you excuse me, take the position B, be exposed to the same initiation torrents or currents that Mark was exposed to. Yeah, so he really was. It was baptism by fire. I think yours will not be as heated.
Okay.
Should you be the candidate selected?
I want to jump on the ambulance for a second and ask you, because my interest is a lot less about filling empty space in this building. It's our building, and it's our building whether we fill it or not. My bigger concerns are the ability to work through challenges that we have in other communities or with other communities. I believe that Whately is strongest when we work collaboratively and weakest when we do not work collaboratively, be it by our design or somebody else's. And I guess I'm wondering what kind of experience you can cite that would, or your own personal characteristics, that would allow you to jump into this job and really embrace the concept of working regionally as opposed to simply working in a silo as the town administrator of the town of Whately.
Sure. Well, I do have a background in regional planning, so I have a good foundation in that. A lot of the towns of Berkshire community had collaborative agreements with building inspectors, boards of health. Northampton has collaborative agreements with other communities, and I agree that communities can't work in silos and need to work together.
Okay, can you set an example of something you've done in your background that had to overcome a challenge with the regional partnerships that were needed to move anything forward?
I guess the most recent one I can think of is working on a bike path from Northampton to Williamsburg. There was considerable opposition at the northern end, both in Northampton and the southern end in Williamsburg, and we had to work through that to get it moving forward. And over a period of years, it finally advanced almost to the town line, not quite.
Bike paths are very contentious issues.
They can be, absolutely.
Yes.
I see you're currently working in the city of Northampton.
I am, yes.
And if you had any, what level are you, any supervisor experience or management experience working with the city?
I have one staff person who works under me as part of the Community Preservation Committee. So we work together on financial issues and other Community Preservation Act concerns.
And who was the next level above you then at the city?
The planning director.
Planning director, okay.
And above that, the mayor.
Okay, and you've been there for 6 years?
Yes.
Is your work advanced or not?
It has. I've taken on more committees since I've started working there. I work very independently. Different things every day. I never quite know what to expect, whether it be wetlands issues or political concerns or lots of different things to do. I mean, we are somewhat limited because it is a small department. There's not really room for advancement unless the director retires, which I don't think he has any plans to do at that point.
What made you go from Berkshire Regional to city?
I didn't want to drive quite that far either, similar to your last town administrator. I was commuting from Charlotte at that point, so that was a long drive. And I also wanted to focus on municipal issues. As much as I liked regional planning, it was somewhat frustrating never to be able to see a project through to the very end, but in a municipality, that's definitely not the issue.
So what is an accomplishment you're most proud of in the last few years? And your role in it, and what is an issue that you are most frustrated about?
Something I'm really proud of is the way the Community Preservation Committee works in Northampton. It was a brand new committee when I started, and now it's sort of much more like a well-oiled machine. It doesn't have the political contention and issues that they did before. Something that I'm frustrated about, I guess sometimes the political process really gets to me when there's a good project that really needs to be shepherded through. Sometimes just a very small number of people who oppose it can stand in the way. Everyone needs to be heard, but it definitely can be frustrating sometimes.
Yes, it can.
You've seen the day-to-day operations, and it's something that I asked Mark a lot about when he was interviewing originally. You've seen the day-to-day operations of a city hall in a city of 30,000-35,000 people. And you've seen what goes on, the buzz that goes on. And it's not a day-to-day that I can relate to, because I've never worked in a town hall, other than sort of working here. But that doesn't count. So I guess I'm looking to see if you thought about, and if you could verbalize, the comparison that you've experienced over the past 6 years in Northampton on the day-to-day. Colleagues, coffee, working together, all this kind of stuff, and the tasks that you're confronted with, and then compare it to what you perceive your life to be like here as the town administrator.
Sure.
On a day-to-day, okay. Or week-to-week, month-to-month, year-to-year basis.
I mean, although Northampton is a larger community than Whately, I don't foresee that my experience would be all that different here. There's a great team in Northampton. We all work together really well. But there's also the town politics, just as there is in every town. And I didn't find it to be a whole lot different than I did in small towns like Sheffield or Great Barrington or Lee. But as long as the team works together, I think that's the most important thing.
Yeah, but you're going from a building of, I don't know, I'm going to guess that a strong 50 to 75 people working in City Hall.
Well, in Northampton, we're sort of separated. So actually in City Hall itself, I think there's only 15 of us.
But in the city, across the board, it's, you know, and there are three and a half. What kind of difference does that strike you as, if any at all?
Northampton works in a way that we're never afraid to pick up the phone and call someone at DPW or the school department or things like that. So I don't, if anything, that will just improve the small town is.
Okay.
We've got a few major projects coming along. In this building, and also dealing with Mass Highway. What's your experience dealing with Mass Highway? And also, we're going to be dealing with remodelers, contractors, whatever, to say remodel, finish our office building here. What's your experience either working for the city or even personal life dealing with these kind of people?
I have quite a bit of experience working with Mass DOT. The Berkshire Regional Planning Commission was the region's MPO, so we worked on the TIP process and those types of things. And I worked pretty closely with the staff at the regional office here with lots of projects in Northampton. And the planning department in Northampton does implement a lot of construction projects, so I do have some familiarity with that, as well as hiring people to work on my home.
So dealt with contractors?
Yes, yeah.
Projects, okay.
What's your experience with the budget process?
That would probably honestly be my weakest point. I do have a lot of experience with the Community Preservation Act. We have an annual budget of about $1.4 million. So we do actually keep close track of that, but I don't have experience actually setting up the budget. I feel confident I would be able to, but
sure.
Haven't had to in the past.
Dad. A lot of, having been to graduate school for public administration, they've got a lot of classes.
Yes.
On the budget process.
Yes, absolutely.
Political economy and whatnot. You touched on this a little bit, but it's a little bit magnified in a small town, I think. People who work in big towns might say, no, you're crazy. And feel free to tell them crazy, and I won't hold it against you. But what do you do when you're confronted, you know, we're confronted with issues here, and not everyone agrees? Paul's right for the most part. A lot of the confrontational ones are passed, but I can see a few that might cause some angst.
Sure.
What do you do? You've got 50 things to do. And by the way, you only have time to do 25 in a day.
That's generally it.
Right. But then, and your schedule's clear. Yeah, you can knock it out. And then day after day after day, and I mean day after day after day, the same few people come into the office, none of which are sitting at this table, and talk with you about how you're going to do things. And they're not asking you how you're going to do it. They're saying, this is how you're going to do things. What do you do?
You do have to listen to people, and you do have to prioritize your time. If it really got to be a problem, I think I would have to talk with members of the select board for advice. You live in this town, and you know these people, and you might have some strategies to be able to deal with that.
And they're not necessarily people that don't have a following.
Mm-hmm.
And they've got good ideas, potentially, but...
I mean, sometimes it does help for people to understand that they are being heard, and that if you can take a few of their ideas and implement those to the extent practicable, sometimes it does help.
Okay.
But I would have to bring it to the select board at some point if it really got to be an issue.
And hopefully we could do something about it.
Hopefully.
Yeah, I'm interested in your people skills, given that the town administrator job, as John has been alluding to, requires, and you've had a lot of experience dealing with different types of people wanting different types of things and expressing their desires in different ways. What would you consider your primary personal strengths in that kind of area?
I think I'm really good at listening to people and making them understand that their concerns really are being heard. I do place a very high emphasis on customer service. If the phone is ringing and someone in the town wants to talk to you about something, it's very important to do that. I deal with a lot of people all day. Some of them are very happy and they have projects that they're shepherding through. Sometimes I'm telling people that they can't do things or that things aren't possible, but I don't have any issues dealing with any of that.
What would you consider your weaknesses? Don't be too hard on yourself. or areas where you're working to improve.
I dealing with large groups of people, and I'm not excellent with. I'm working on addressing that. So if I had to address a town meeting, that wouldn't be my most forward to event of the year, but I wouldn't have an issue with it, but it's working on getting better at it.
Everybody hates public speaking.
Yes,
well, not everybody.
Most people.
But definitely one of my colleagues who's a politician. Thank you for being candid. It's not easy.
What's your, I guess, response to work at evenings? We have a lot of evening meetings, sometimes weekends, not too often, but I know Mark was. And others take stuff home evenings or weekends. They're on email sending us stuff like that. Do you do that now? And do you actually see that as a concern if that was required of you?
No, absolutely not. I have my work email connected to my phone, although I'm in no way obligated to do that. It just makes me feel like I'm better able to do my job. And I don't have any concerns with extended hours. It's just sort of, it comes with the territory.
I hope you have a laptop carrying case.
I do.
I asked about the frequent visitor. What about if... What about if one of the three of us were to come in on a regular basis and say, you gotta do this today. You gotta call this person, I don't know what it would be. But it's one of the three of us comes in and tells you how to do your job. What do you do?
I mean, to some extent, I do serve the select board, so it, as long as the requests are reasonable, I certainly wouldn't have an issue with that. But I guess I'd have to figure out how the town really operates, but I wouldn't have any concerns with people stopping by and asking things.
And I'm sure Mark or Lynn would say I'm guilty of this myself at times. How do you think the difference in operations and process is between the city of Northampton, where David walks into your office, you better do it, or a town that's run by a select board, and a select board member walks into your office and tells you to do it? What's the difference?
There isn't one really. And if, as long as the request makes sense and is reasonable, if it's something that needs to be done, then that's fine.
I'm interested in, I'm a teacher, so I've been a teacher on different levels and dealing with a lot of people and trying to assign a lot of work and then trying to evaluate it requires considerable organizational skills. And I see town manager or town administrator as not much different in that respect. As we've acknowledged, there's a lot of balls in the air usually. And I'm curious about how or what strategies you feel you've evolved to deal with complex ongoing situations in terms of organizational.
Sure. I do keep a running to-do list. I didn't used to write it down, but as I had more and more things to do, I do. It may be different from one day to the next. Yesterday, I set a certain list of priorities for today. I might go to the office today and find that something jumps to the top, but that happens all the time. So it's just a matter of figuring out deadlines and priorities and what needs to be done first.
Have you figured out something that you feel has really helped you manage your responsibilities?
I do keep a Google Calendar, which I think has helped tremendously. The to-do list is just a sort of a running tally of things that need to get done, and when they're done, move them to the bottom, and that seems to have helped quite a bit.
I ask these questions because I'm always looking for ways to improve myself, so it's not Google Calendar. I'll check it out. But seriously, I think that's important. I think Mary Ellen would agree that anybody who's faced with a job that requires such disparate issues and responsibilities at any given moment and on an ongoing basis, in order to survive, and my survival was the first year that I taught at a high school, I had to evolve strategies quickly, and nobody mentored me, really. So I was on the ground running or getting run over. And I got out from under the stampede, but in part because I did evolve some strategies. And I worked with associates, and I think you're fortunate in being in a job situation where you've got two very experienced and skilled people who are familiar with what you likely come up against and be able to help you and be willing to help you.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's good.
I've definitely learned not to be dead set on getting one particular thing done necessarily. I'd love to get this done today, but other things often jump to the top of the list. That's okay.
Yeah, we were having, I guess, some difficulty or concern about getting things done here the last year, and we came up with a list of priorities with Mark's help. We've got maybe 30, 40 different activities on here, because every meeting something new would come up, and how does that fit in the priority schedule, and we kind of prioritize stuff low, medium, and high, and been working on achieving some of them issues on that list. Have you done anything like that to help prioritize, not on a day-to-day basis, but long-term, say 6-9 months, a year? Have you developed anything like that, or envision working with something like that?
Yeah, I mean, we do have the planning department does have sort of a running projects list. There's definitely, there's high priority short-term items, there's high priority long-term items, and then there's things that fall in between that. For example, we have a State Hospital memorial bench that's been a standing item on the Historic Commission agenda as long as I've been there, just because it's a small group with not a lot of money trying to tackle a pretty big project. It's not super high priority, but they are plugging away. But then there's something like a bike path where you have to work with MassDOT to get design stuff.
I'm going to follow up on both of these guys for a second. Paul had mentioned you're going to be walking into a situation with two people who are here most frequently, who one has, this is the second time she's been the interim town administrator, and our treasurer collector was the town administrator for 10 years, 9 years. I've been on the board now for 12 years, and she was the town administrator for 9 of them. But you're the town administrator now. But they're both incredibly important people, but you're still the town administrator now, and talented and knowledgeable and blah, blah, blah. How do you create the atmosphere where, you know, you've got your job to do, but you also, what do you do?
And it's absolutely important to take all of their knowledge and skills and use those and make sure that the day-to-day tasks that they're working on are things that are really important and match their skill set. And politically, that's a tough situation. I guess you have to just work on it day-to-day and try and make sure that they're happy and fulfilled.
And then Fred's comment reminded me of talking about priorities, and it's something that I increasingly think we need to focus on, because we're going to leave money on the table if we don't. What experience do you have, if any, with the community compact?
I'm aware of it. I don't have a tremendous amount of personal experience with it.
But you've written grants?
Yes, absolutely.
Because those grants are going to be left on the table if we don't.
That's bad. Bad with money, okay.
So do you have a lot of history dealing with people at the state level?
Yes, extensively, and a lot of different state agencies.
I have two questions. One is about a concern that I have with the town right now. It has, the question is really, do you have any, or have you thought of any ways in which a small town like this, with our demographics and our geography, what can we do, in your opinion, to enhance our revenue stream in terms of economic development?
And I guess it's hard to answer without knowing the specifics of Whately, but it's important to have a good mix of industry, business, residential, maximize on being right next to 91 and having that access there. I see this as an industrial park, that's a good start. It's something I have to look into in a lot of detail. But
you're familiar with zoning issues.
Yes, very much so.
We do have some challenges, but we also have some assets that I think are untapped and would be good to put on our priority list at some point. The other question I had was one we're supposed to ask, and there are 10 questions here, which we haven't really stuck to, is the classic interview question: where do you see yourself in 5 years or 10 years?
I'd like to be a town administrator. That I've been working towards that for a long time. I really enjoy planning and I enjoy working in Northampton, but I think you can integrate all of that experience into being a successful town administrator.
I agree.
Is there something you could think of that you're doing in your current job, or let's say the city does, that would improve our operations here?
I think so. You may already do some of them, but I think I've learned a lot about some best practices and also some things that don't work all that well that maybe we should avoid that I did right here.
Like what? Give us some examples.
You do have a great website. I did check that out. It seems like you're doing a lot of the technological stuff, which I think is really helpful. Communicating between town departments is really important. I don't know what the processes are for doing that. It depends on what's working now and what's not, I guess.
What questions do you have for us?
What do you like most about Whately? At least.
What day is it?
Friday.
Personally, I like the character of the town, but knowing that larger areas with more options for life exist. I like living in a town where I'm not 20 feet on each side of my house next to a neighbor, in my personal case, but that I can get to Boston in less than 2 hours, New York City in less than 3 hours, and in Montreal in less than 5 hours, and experience stuff that just isn't available here. I, you know, can go to a baseball game, go to a symphony concert, go to a museum, but I can still come back here and have the quiet. Personally, that's pretty appealing to me. I wish we had more economic development, but that's me.
What were you asking?
Your most favorite and least favorite things about Whately.
About Whately? Well, I guess I'm a native of Whately. I was born and raised here, left for my career with the federal government for 37 years, and came back, same house, remodeled and stuff, and the schools I went to are now closed or used for other office space, so I guess I'd like to preserve some of that history and stuff, and I guess we just feel we fit in here, raised here, come back frequently to visit family, friends, and their relatives in the area, so we just feel quiet, in some quiet nature of the town. Although it has changed a lot, it's getting more farming oriented than it ever has been before. So, and I guess I'm here to stay forever, I guess. We just like it here, and it's a good location. Yeah, it doesn't have all the amenities of big cities, but we're not necessarily into all of that either, so.
I don't know about, I think I'd say, agree with both my colleagues here. Whenever I go anywhere far away, I always love coming back. And I really love my neighbors. We're a very tight little village in West Whately. So I like that a lot. I love the fact that Whately represents what's best in small town America in terms of having a democratic form of government in town meeting, which I think is just terrific. I wish more people would come to town meeting and express themselves. And I feel comfortable about talking to my neighbors, even those I don't know very well. And I think Whately's just a beautiful area. And it also has a lot of the advantages of New York and Boston without the density. We've got great art and culture around, and not so much crime and pollution, and people who share a lot of similar values along those lines. So I could stand living in Northampton if I had to, but I'll stay here while I can.
What else?
What's your vision of Whately for the future? That's a tough one, especially if it's
And it's easy when it's an easy one for me. I think we need to figure out how to enter the 21st century in a more concrete way. I think we have to figure out the economic development piece. I think we need to figure out how to attract some more commercial / industrial revenue to the town without ruining the town's character. I think we need to figure out how to reverse the population trend, which is sharply, well, it's somewhat going down, but that's largely because of an aging population. That's not unlike most of the communities in Western Massachusetts, I understand that. But once our population starts to pass away, we're in trouble unless we figure out how to attract more people. And that means attracting jobs, working with our regional neighbors to figure out how to attract small companies to the area so that people have a reason to come live here because of jobs and income, and so they can take advantage of all the assets that we already have. But we need to figure out how to make economic development work, and we haven't yet. And again, it's a regional problem, not just a Whately problem. But, you know, we've got a school whose half the population is school choice. Half. What do you do if those school choice students all of a sudden find that where they come from is a better option all of a sudden again? We need to figure out how to get families to move in here. And it can't be the simple answer of, well, the tax base is too high, because it's just not. It's not too high. We need to find economic development that allows people to afford the relatively modest taxes that we have to pay. That's my vision. We gotta grow. These guys might differ.
Well, I think we're an aging community, and a lot of people been here for years and stay here for years, and them are kind of the ones that come and vote and tell us what they don't want changed. A lot of people want to keep it as a rural community. And there's a lot of emphasis on keeping, a concern of preserving farmland. If you're preserving all farmland and open space, where do you get development? Well, you got Route 5 and 10 maybe is an option, or the industrial park over here. But other than that, there really isn't that much unless you go in some wooded areas. And you know, we do have two areas that are being developed for housing. But these are the high income, they're the Hospital Hill type of areas.
Yep.
There's nothing lower level, income level than that to bring people in. People buying these are not necessarily from the immediate area either. So there's that concern, like Jonathan said, to bring more people in, and you know, it's development versus farmland. And you get a bunch of farmers that are old timers, been here for years, and they don't want houses or parking lots or pavement on their property. They want to preserve that in the condition it is today for their own use, because a lot of it is farmed, or for their future generations to continue. So I think that's going to be a concern for years to come. How do you deal with that balance?
Another balance is the preservation of a sort of cultural identity as Whately per se versus I think the necessity to have a little more regionalization in terms of services, and that is a very hard nut to crack working with other towns. Everybody wants to preserve their sense of place and character, and on the other hand, there are certain services that I won't mention because I don't want to get in trouble, but I think would be more efficiently done regionally and not necessarily sacrifice the sort of cultural character aspects that people associate with a particular town. And I think that's connected to a lot of other more, not global, but you know, larger issues and trends in society. So, you know, in some ways we're living in an archaic system politically and economically, but So change is inevitable. It's just trying to figure out what kind of change you want, shepherding it in as well as possible. So I'd like to see us work with other towns more, not duplicate services so much, and yet, maintain our sense of place in history, which a large part is what these guys have been saying about the agricultural open space part. Although I live in the more woodsy part, I'd like that too.
Okay, sounds like a turning point, almost. A lot of challenges, but opportunities as well.
Yeah.
Do you have any experiences, like Paul has mentioned, working with regionalizing some services and things like that with neighboring communities? Do you have any experience doing that?
When I worked at the Planning Commission, I did work on regionalizing boards of health.
Boards of health?
So a lot of those inspection services were done with one general, with one localized agent who would go to different towns.
Okay, well, that's like we have here, the Franklin County inspection program.
I also worked on a study for regionalizing purchasing for departments of public works, so buying guardrails and paint and sand and those types of things. So pooling everybody's needs together and getting better prices.
That's good. I think Franklin County does that here, don't they?
They do.
Extent.
Keep this young stuff sometimes. Okay, well, unless you have any other questions.
That's all I can think of.
Okay, well, thank you very much for coming in.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it very much.
Pleasure to meet you.
Thank you. Nice to meet you.
How are you?
I'm well, thanks. How are you?
Good, thanks. Your name again?
Charles Crabtree.
Charles, how are you? My name is Jonathan Edwards. I'm the chair of the Board of Selectmen. Suckboard here in Whately. I'll have these guys introduce themselves.
Yeah, I'm Fred Orlowski, member of the board.
I'm Paul.
Do you have an SPP connection or a school public policy connection at UMass?
Do I?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You look familiar to me.
I might.
And there's not a lot of reason for me to.
I got an MPPA there, six years ago.
I feel like I've seen you at.
Do you go to those events? I don't even get invited. I got my MPA from there 20 something years ago, and I don't even get invited.
I don't know. I've been around UMass often. I do a concert series. Maybe you've been to Watermelon Wednesdays. Is
that okay? Okay. Thank you very much for coming to talk with us today. Thank you for your interest in working with the town of Whately. We are a three-person board and this is my 12th year on the board. We are a board that has had the same town administrator year and a half. Prior to that, about 10 years, nine and a half years. We are a well-run town with a lot of issues. As we continue to just mature. We are looking for someone who can help lead us and work with the three of us or whoever comes after us on a number of current issues, and as we have learned over the past 2 years, issues that we had no idea that were gonna crop up will crop up. So we're looking for someone with an awful lot of energy, someone who's not afraid to answer my midnight emails, someone who's not afraid to take their laptop home, but has the personal skills to interact with 1,400 other people in town. So I guess I'll start off the conversation and start it off the way I start off hundreds of interviews that I've given in my life. Why are you here?
Well, so my background has been a sort of odd mix of working in community outreach or nonprofit organizations, retail sales, and administrative type work before I came up here for graduate school. And I moved up here thinking that I was going to do international policy or international development. But the program at SPP is so process-oriented that I became much more interested in that side of policy and administration, and realized that I feel like I can have the most immediate effect or the most immediate impact working in that capacity instead of, you know, going to be a cog in the machine of the UN or UNESCO or whoever.
Okay. And but why Whately? I mean, why did you decide to submit a resume to a town of 1,400 people to be the town administrator?
A lot of it was just down to the fact, so I'm from Memphis, Tennessee. I moved up here 2 years ago to start my master's program. And I've really fallen in love with being in the Valley. And this seems like one of the best opportunities to put the skills that I came up here to learn to work while still being able to stay, you know, around Amherst and Northampton, and just in this area, getting to deal with the people here that have been so welcoming to me.
Okay. I'm going to pass it to these guys now.
What do you know about Whately?
Not a whole lot that I haven't, you know, done for research on your website. I've driven through a couple of times, especially a couple of times in the last week or two. but you know, I've done a lot of research on your website, but I haven't had much interaction with you guys.
What issues have we been dealing with? Do you any idea on that, or any seeing anything in the media on what we've been doing the last year and a half?
My understanding is that mostly it's trying to figure out how to grow with the number of people after the teachers and people from that are commuting out to Amherst and Northampton, trying to figure out how to expand to different communities.
So my concern is, looking at your resume, what appears to be a lack of experience with regard to jobs similar to municipal governance. And I'm wondering if you can comment on that and make me feel a little more reassured that you could get up to speed very quickly. This is a quick transition for us, so we're looking for somebody to get on the ground running. And what in your experience do you believe best prepares you for being our town administrator? And what do you think, well, let me preface that by asking first, what do you think a town administrator is all about? And then what do you think, in your experience, best prepares you for assuming those roles?
So my understanding of what a town administrator is all about is being the sort of middleman between the 1,500 people or so here and you guys, the face of the policies, and the person who does the day-to-day management of and administration of the town. Why I think I would be suitable as a candidate, despite not having a background in municipal governance, would be down to, I guess, the skill sets that I've developed in other positions. I came up in retail sales, so I have strong interpersonal skills and ability to interact with people. I have exceptional organizational skills. I worked as a project lead of a complex graduate research project as part of my capstone project at UMass. I've worked in leadership positions for startup nonprofits, startup language schools in the U.S. and abroad. And throughout these experiences have learned to, you know, develop budgets and do practical research, not just academic style research that informs decisions, either my own decisions depending on my position within the organization or senior management's decisions.
Like any town, we have people who care an awful lot about the town. And different people demonstrate that passion for the town in different ways. There are some people who are passionate about the town that voice their opinions quite frequently, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. That being said, they're not necessarily any of the people in this room. And their asset is that they're passionate and they have some knowledge about different things, but they are not elected, appointed, anything. And I'm not opposed to relatively little experience. I think the graduate degree is something that's critically valuable. And I think it gives a foundation for effective practical application of what you've learned. That being said, someone without the experience, how do you deal with the people who know the town better than you, have good ideas, have strong personalities, and they're in here every day trying to influence how you do your job? Let me tell you how to do your job, Charles. You're not doing it, sir. Let me tell you how you need to do it. How do you deal with that? And they know you don't have any experience. And they're trying to take advantage of that. Not in a bad way, but they just...
Right.
How do you deal with that?
That's a good question. I think I've always had a lot of confidence in my ability to trust my own decision making and to make good decisions, especially when I'm able to, you know, ground that decision in some sort of objective information. So I would be, I think my reaction to that sort of thing would be to listen very carefully and actively to their concerns, but to also take comments or advice from people on the different town committees that are relevant to this, and to make a decision that's informed by multiple parties and my own judgment instead of being pushed in a direction by a loud member of the public, I guess.
So, I'm very interested in, and by the way, now for the softball, as opposed to your lack of experience, which, as Jonathan said, is not necessarily a bad thing. The good thing is that you are relatively fresh, and that's something that we appreciate. And I appreciate it, and I appreciate someone who can, is open and willing to learn in a new environment. And you can only do that if, as you say, you employ the skills, the organizational skills and the personal skills that you alluded to. And I was glad to hear about your development of budgets. But I'd like to get a little more granular about the organizational skills and personal skills, but particularly the organizational skills, because town administrator is primarily a managerial position. So I would like to know, anecdotally, necessarily, of how you view your evolution in terms of your ability to manage projects effectively and efficiently. So, with specifically, have you learned any tricks of the trade that help you, that you can rely on to help you negotiate a tricky program? For instance, we're dealing right now, and have been for several, seems like decades, but only really months, years, of integrating this building, filling this building with occupants. They have to be public sector occupants because of our loan on the building, but we just bought this building. And we want to accommodate a regional entity, public entity in part of the building. And we may also want to accommodate a school department group And so these are disparate interests, pursuing disparate goals, but both want a new home. And we're offering this part of the building, that part of the building. That's a potential home for them. But it's complicated because they have different needs and they're different people. And there is some, there has been some political contentiousness in dealing with this situation. So I'm wondering if you could give me or us some specific skills that you feel you've learned over the course of your limited experience that would help you, help us negotiate filling up the space, getting people in here to help us, you know, keep paying for the building and create a revenue stream.
So I guess there are two things that come up for me there as instances that I maybe can speak to that type of experience.
Sure.
I guess in the summer of 2013, probably June 2013, a friend of mine brought me on as the venue coordinator for the Memphis International Jazz Festival, mm-hmm. which was a small inaugural year run of a little cast of international musicians in the South Main District of Memphis. And pretty soon after I came in, our funding fell through. And so we had to pivot to figure out how we were going to house I think almost 20 different musicians across four nights of music. And I was the venue coordinator, so it fell to me to figure out where we're going to put these people with our remaining limited money. And the plan that I came up with was to approach local restaurants in this artsy little neighborhood who already program music, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday nights, and to make them an offer of, you know, if you'll use your programming money to bring in our jazz musicians, we'll put you on our playbill. We'll come up with some sort of promotional thing where people that buy a wristband to the festival get, you know, half off of an appetizer or something if they come to your restaurant. And so I worked with, I guess, 11 or 12 different restaurants and little art galleries throughout this neighborhood to find a home for all of our musicians. And then for our headline acts, we put those. That's where the money went. The second instance that I can think of that's more recent is the I guess project management process lead experience that I had on our capstone research project, where I was managing five other graduate students on a project that was split quantitatively and qualitatively, and then within the qualitative group, it was split again. So I was dealing with, you know, two teams split into two and two and two more people again. And one of the early issues that we ran into was figuring out what one of our case study countries was going to be. And we'd started desk research, and one of our qualitative researchers had done fantastic desk research on the country of Mali, which was somewhere that we were interested in, but the quantitative data set didn't match. And so I had to, you know, to mediate between the qualitative team and the quantitative team to figure out, you know, can we figure out a different way to make this work? Can we find a different data set? To sort of just run through the list of the options that were available to us, or do we need to switch to a different country? And that's what we ultimately ended up doing. And I had to, you know, to go sit down with you know, one of my researchers who had done fantastic work, just objectively a great research that would have been a fantastic case study on its own, but it wouldn't have been comprehensive in the way that we needed it to be. So I you know, she made her case for keeping that case study, but ultimately I had to shift us over to a different area.
So how does that apply to a challenge or task, whatever you want to characterize it as, that you think you would confront as a town administrator of a town like Whately? How do you apply that skill and that experience to real life in Whately as a town administrator?
I guess I see as the overarching theme an ability to gather the necessary research, hear from the relevant parties, and then make what I believe to be the best decision once all of the information is in, which seems like it would be a fairly crucial part of any management role. And by extension to work in the town of Whately as well.
Notice in your resume, you've got two positions for the same time period, research assistant and process lead. Is that one position? You're doing both?
No, sir.
Or explain the difference and why there's an overlap. Both cover the same time period.
Right.
One part-time or both part-time or what?
Both were part-time. The research assistant position is graduate contract work where I work with a variety of different researchers through UMass over a period of 2 years on supporting their research projects. The process lead position was part of our capstone project where we were working with a client, Verite, out of Belchertown on an independent research project that was that we led. We wrote the budget, we wrote the research plan and research question. And so the research assistant positions are supporting roles and the process lead is the one that I manage.
What school are you under at UMass?
The School of Public Policy.
Public Policy, okay. And do you coordinate with other schools there at all, or is it just Public Policy?
Through the research assistant position, I coordinated with other schools because for the first year of that project, I was working on legal research and had to talk to UConn and Harvard to get access to legal databases that UMass doesn't have available to them, and ended up having to go to Harvard to get in touch with the legal librarian there and to open up access to do some of that research. But for the most part, it's isolated within UMass.
So what do you think? You graduated from UMass Public Policy. You've got a master's degree. You are now going to apply, as I mentioned before, what you learned theoretically at some level with some practicality. And now you show up on July 1st. I'm just picking a date. When you sit down at your desk and you meet the staff and you find out where the men's room is and you do all those kinds of things, what do you do next? You're the town administrator. What do you do next?
I don't know. That's a good question. I think the first thing I would want to do is to talk to the chairs of the various committees about what they see as the most pressing issues that they're facing as a committee, what they see as the most pressing issues that the town is facing, and get as much information out of them as possible to get, you know, as quickly up to date on, what I can expect to, what issues I can expect to deal with as soon as I'm able to.
Okay. You're also walking into a situation where what's your title these days? Not your interim title, what's your title these days?
Administrative assistant and assistant treasurer collector.
Okay. Where you've got your administrative assistant and assistant treasurer collector and the treasurer collector both having filled your shoes. One on an interim basis twice now, quite ably. And then the treasurer collector was the town administrator for 9+ years. How do you, and you've got me, who's been here 12 years, Paul has been here 11 years, and Fred's more fresh. How do you leverage that experience and perspective, series of perspectives, while still maintaining your autonomy as the town administrator that's got to make decisions on behalf of the select board?
I guess this is maybe, and I'm interested in your opinion on whether or not this is naive of me to think, but that all sounds like that all sounds like opportunity to me, to have people surrounding me that that have, you know, have experience in the role, can guide me as I, you know, go up the learning curve to entering the position. And so maybe on day one, I'm not able to provide my own 10-year plan for the town, but it seems like I would have great access to resources that could help inform that, and a diversity of resources, so it's not just one person in my ear pushing me in a specific direction, as we get back to the, I guess, the example of the loud person at a town meeting from earlier. I think that, I guess one of the things that has been consistent for me across all of my different work experiences is the value of having diverse and distinct voices and opinions in running anything. I think it's been especially pronounced in organizations where I've been sort of a manager and had to make my own decisions. I've never felt like I was being, I guess, pushed or persuaded in a direction that I didn't want to be pushed in. But it is good to have those other viewpoints to inform decision making.
By the way, I am glad you said that on day one you couldn't form your 10-year plan. Truth be told, if anyone said that, even with 25 years experience, I know I'd probably stop listening. So,
kind of two-part question. What mechanism or process used to manage your time? And also, related to that, a lot of our meetings are evenings, and not only with the town here committees, but even other towns in the surrounding area. Do you see that as a problem, meaning with your time, and how do you fit that in? How would you do that? And how do you manage time in general, I guess?
So as far as evening meetings being a problem, that's, I don't think, so much of an issue for me. I've only been up here for 2 years, so I don't know that many people, and most of the people that I do know just moved away as we finished our graduate program. So it's not like I have the most vibrant extracurricular life at the moment. So it'd be good to have, you know, a consistent thing to have these type of meetings to come to. As far as how I manage my time, I'm kind of a nerd in that capacity, I guess. I've got different calendar management apps that I use. I've got an email app that lets me schedule responses to emails, so it'll pop back up as new again, but it'll stay out of my way until the point that I'm ready to deal with it. And I'm just very, very schedule oriented, planning out my days, planning out, coming in the morning and spending 15 minutes coming up with everything that needs to get done that day, every project that I need to touch in that specific day, and then figuring out how to use that time and keeping all of that very clear in my head and very, you know, organized on paper.
You do work in evenings or at home on weekends or whatever?
Absolutely.
Because graduate school, you bet.
Yeah.
So I have a concern and a compliment. The compliment first is that it appears to me, from what limited exposure I've had to you and your resume here, that you would be very quick learner, a quick study. I see you have a summa cum laude in history from Memphis, University of Memphis. So that's the good, that makes me feel good. A fresh, young person looking to establish a track record and do a good job is a good thing that I'm personally looking for. And we just experienced with our former town administrator, who worked out very well, despite lack of actual experience in this particular position, although he did have some municipal administration experience. But my concern is, given such a bright and, I think, engaging individual
The other thing I worry about is that we will go through the process of hiring somebody and working with them and getting them up to speed. And then the question is, what do you see yourself doing in 5 years, I guess? And my concern being, will you be here for, you know, a duration of some extent? I mean, so that's my concern. Your career trajectory, since you're basically starting out.
As I see it, I mean, in thinking about where I would like to be in 5 years, I would still really like to be in this area. I feel really at home in the Pioneer Valley. I rock climb, and the opportunities to do that are far greater than they would be going back to Memphis or any of the other places that I've lived. It's been a really good fit for me. As far as options for what I would like to do, the only other thing that I could think to want to do in the area would be to do research in some capacity, but that's not really my passion, and as much as it's something I'm qualified to do to an extent, this seems a lot more in line with, even though I do lack the one-to-one experience, it uses the skills that I think are my strongest a lot better than working as a research assistant or working in program evaluation. I could do those things, but I don't think I would enjoy doing those things the way that I would like to do, you know, overseeing the moving parts and doing administrative work. So as far as where I think I would be in 5 years, if I did get the position, I don't see any reason why I wouldn't want to still be here.
So if you would expand on, I like that phrase, your passion, your occupational passion, how you want to engage yourself in your career, and what it is about a path of including a town administrator that sort of responds to that, a passion there. If you know what I'm getting at. Yeah, so what is it about this kind of work, or at least what you think this kind of work is about, that excites you or interests you?
So from reading the job description and watching one or two of your select board meetings on YouTube, it just seems like it wouldn't be a position where I showed up and did the exact same thing every day. And I've done that work, and I know how much I don't want to do that again. It seems like there are so many different communities or committees to interact with, so many different things going on at a sort of fine-grained level, that there would always be something new that I could jump into, something else I could learn, and some other direction which I could develop. And that's really exciting for me as someone that's coming out of a master's program and trying to put the skills that I have into practical use, like I said, and then to develop further, you know, professionally. And so just, I mean, I won't pretend to have, you know, an expert level of understanding of the position, but even from the job description, it seems like I would be doing so many different things. I would be growing in so many different directions. And that's just really exciting to me. That's what I'm looking for in a position.
You're obviously a smart guy, and I agree with Paul, probably a pretty quick learn. I'm very attuned and interested in people's skills. I think the job of town administrator is both knowledge-based and people-based. And I know I kind of asked this before, but if you were to be offered this position and take it, we would obviously have a variety of reasons why we offered it to you. Many of which might be lost on the other people in town. So how do you deal with the people who come to you at varying degrees of nicety? Some pleasantness can be and some not so. Say, why did they offer you this job? Why didn't you go after this grant? Did you not know about it? Did you even talk to this person? Are you aware of this, OPEB? Why are we in deficit by X hundreds of thousands of dollars on retirement? I can rifle off to you 30 questions that I am pretty sure you're not going to have an answer for. And that's okay. But it's supposed to be okay with me because I'm supposed to work with whoever the town administrator is, and these guys are. But the people on the different committees and the people that come in here looking for answers or thinking that they know what the answer should be aren't going to give you that leverage necessarily or that comfort zone. How do you deal with those people? You didn't know about a grant. They're going to set your experience. You didn't know about retirement insurance. They're going to set your experience. How do you make sure you maintain your credibility in those scenarios?
That's tough.
I'm sorry.
The thing that comes most to mind for me, and this will maybe speak to my ability to learn fairly quickly and to get bored fairly quickly. I worked for immediately following undergrad. I worked at Fastenal Company, which is an industrial hardware store. Not a field that I had any experience in. I was the least knowledgeable and least equipped person in the building. And I was customer facing. I was, you know, manning the counter and gathering the stuff that was ordered or purchased and doing some of that myself. And absolutely the first few weeks of me being there, I was frustrating to deal with for them because they had to do a lot of work explaining this to me. But I also spent a lot of time off the clock reading through our manuals and learning and getting up to speed as quickly as I can. So through my retail experience, I've learned to some extent how to deal with people in difficult situations when I'm on the spot, when I have to come up with an answer, even though there's not really a good answer to give, or it's an answer that they don't want to hear. And so I think I've developed some capacity to handle those situations with some degree of grace. I think it would be tough. I think it would be difficult for an initial period, but I would work as hard as I could to get through that as quickly as possible. I guess is the best I can tell you.
And I'm admittedly painting a bleak picture. Mm-hmm. I mean, don't think that it's all, but I'm purposely painting a bleak picture.
I understand.
You guys got any more?
Not particularly good or germane.
What questions do you have for us? Because that might lead to more questions from us.
I guess to the extent possible, what can you tell me about a typical day in the life of the job?
I'm gonna before I answer it, I'm gonna throw it back to you. What do you
want to worry?
What do you anticipate
number six?
It seems to me like a day in the life would probably be juggling a lot of different balls at once, and moving from project to project or issue to issue, and I don't know, having hands in a lot of different things at once.
My answer would be it depends upon the time of year. Starting in December. I was supposed to say January, but it really should be December.
the budget starts to dominate your day in the life, week in the life. Different committees come to you with, at different times, and that's where you're correct in saying you're going to be juggling a lot of things because you don't necessarily know what's going to land on your plate on any given day. Although forecasting is always nice. I think that staying in touch with department heads on a regular basis while not micromanaging them is something that you're going to need to do on a regular basis. And I say while not micromanaging them, I say that largely because I don't like micromanagers, but also because they're pretty seasoned. And if you try to micromanage them from your lens, it'll fall on deaf ears. And finding time to figure out what priorities you should bring to us to say, I really think we need to focus on X, Y, or Z. We are a relatively hands-off board, or we historically have been a relatively hands-off board that expects the town administrator to come to us with priorities, and we go to that person with priorities when it becomes important to us, or because, you know, for a variety of reasons. But we want someone who will be our staff, but also our leader, might not be the right word, but to make us smarter. Guys, what do you got?
Yeah, I think that personally, I'm a very hands-off select board member. I don't micromanage. In fact, maybe I don't manage enough. I'm supposed to be the liaison between the police department, and basically I let people do their job unless I hear complaints to the contrary, and then I get involved out of necessity. We're a part-time board. I don't know about these other two guys. They may spend a lot of hours every night going over town issues. I can't say that I do that. But I am concerned and involved in the welfare of the town, and I would rely heavily on your role to keep me abreast of what's going on so that it doesn't get to a point where we need to take steps that are unfortunate or unpleasant. You're very fortunate, I think, coming in now compared to the previous administrators, in that we are now, to address John's concern about, you know, December and January as being busy times, we're meeting with the finance committee regularly together for the first time, and I think that's a godsend in terms of reducing the prospects of miscommunication between what should be budgetary priorities or policy priorities. And I think we're going a long way in straightening out the difference. And there is a difference. We're a policy board, not a budgetary board. So we're responsible for the budget and assigning policies on what we want to see or think we should spend money on. And the finance committee is to say, tell us if that's a good idea given our revenues and all that stuff. At least that's my take on it. And I think that's been a somewhat rocky road, but is now being smoothed out. So that's much to the new town administrator's advantage, I think. But there are issues with that, and I think the real skills of a town administrator, among the real skills, are to be able to navigate situations where, like between boards, there's a lack of communication. And coming up with suggestions or telling us that there's a lack of communication and helping us resolve those difficulties. And that takes a lot of insight, and it takes a lot of people skills, as well as I think you would have no trouble with a lot of the other more, you know, traditional quantitative skills and project management, making sure your calendar's full and not overfull, but efficiently organized, and keeping us up to speed on what needs to be done when. Because as far as I'm concerned, it's, you know,
I don't always keep totally on top of things. I may be sacrificing my next term, but saying these things. But I'm being honest, and that's a very valuable skill that I rely on. I need to be communicated. Mary Ellen's been very good, Mark was very good, Lynn was very good about sending out emails to us, apprising us of whatever situation was happening, and that's a good thing. Now that we're over here, farther away from my house, I drop in even less often than I would at the old town offices. So I need that even more. So I'm just putting that out there as something that I would appreciate our next administrator being willing and on top of.
I'm going to add to something just real quickly, and I would say this to anybody regardless of their years of experience, but especially given the, I'm not being critical, I'm just calling it like it is, it's the relative lack of experience. We rely heavily on working partnerships with other towns in the region. And I think, especially early on, but it wouldn't stop, just frequency might ebb a little bit. Working with the other town administrators, Deerfield, Sunderland, Hatfield, wherever, maybe creating relationships that don't yet exist as well as they should. I would add Conway to the list of the regulars. That's something that's going to be pretty important to you. Because you're going to learn from them, because they've all been town administrators for quite a while. But they also know the issues. They know state schedules. They know a lot of different things. And I'm sure, because they need a strong functioning Whately as much as we need a strong functioning town X, Y, or Z. And I'm sure that they will give you that time. And how often are the regular meetings of the four town administrators at this point? Are they regular?
They're regular, I'm not sure. I know they meet separately, and they also meet with the school as well.
So. Right. So, I mean, some of that structure is already set up.
Right.
But I think it's going to be important for who's ever in this position to ramp it up a bit. I'm a big believer in regional cooperation. I think we are dead in the water if we don't cooperate regionally, even more than we do right now. We're a town of 1,500 people. Deerfield's a town of 5,000 people, whatever it is. Sunderland's a town of 3,000 people, a largely transient population because of UMass. We rely on each other. And so that's a big part of your function as well.
It, just as an aside, that's been one of the more interesting things for me moving up here from an area where we have a lot of small towns and we have a lot of rural communities, but we don't have a lot of these councils of governments or something like my college system where there's this collaborative work. The capacity for towns up here and even institutions like the colleges up here to do that is has been a little bit eye-opening for me coming up from the South, and in a positive
way. We're, as John alluded to, we're a low-density population and a sort of archaic form of, I guess, self-management. So regionalization is important. And along with regionalization and being able to navigate those waters while maintaining cultural and rural character is economic development. And while that may seem antithetical to maintaining open space and rural character, which is one of Whately's big selling points as a place to live, aside from being in the Five College Pioneer Valley area where there's a lot of culture without a lot of the hassles of the city, we do need to, we're highly dependent on property tax, and this is a big concern as we're an aging community with a fairly stable population. So there's not a lot of growth. Growth has its own issues, so does lack of growth or shrinkage. And so I know you're not a community development specialist or an economic development specialist, but it would be nice to know that we weren't missing any opportunities to expand our economic potential. We have an industrial park here. We have some zoning possibilities for further economic development, and you know, it would be nice to have somebody whose ear is on the ground, listening for potential development in that realm. And so that's a concern I know we all share.
You know, it dawns on me, because of the number of things that we need to be reactive and proactive about. And it's something that our former town administrator was able to do quite easily and seamlessly, because she was, her family's been in Whately for like 1,000 years. And Mark was less able to do it, partially because of geography, and so much was going on when he was here. But going to having, you know, it's our job as elected officials to go to church suppers and things like that. I think it would be wonderful if the new town administrator did those things as well, because they're the face of the town on a daily basis. We're the face of the town on a not so daily basis, or unless people go seek us out. But the town administrator is the face of the town on a daily basis. And to build a relationship and a partnership with just anybody in town, going to the church suppers, stopping in on the Historical Society when they're going through their collection, doing these things. And I get you have to balance that with your desk gets littered with responsibilities, would be a very valuable piece of work. And if it's something that you or any town administrator was comfortable with, and I really think they need to be comfortable with it, it's something that needs to be structured into a work day, just like taking a job is structured into your day or whatever it is, because it's really important. That's what I got. Any other questions?
I guess just, and I guess we've sort of touched on this, but as far as the most important skills for the incoming person to have, but what do you see the biggest challenges of stepping into the role at this point?
Well, I think the town administrator position, for someone who is pretty carte blanche about it, is it's a microcosm of a situation where you have to manage and keep up to speed with a disparate amount of, with a number of disparate tasks and responsibilities. And Mary Ellen can correct me if I'm wrong, but if I were coming into this job with your background, I would be trying to figure out a system for managing a lot of response. First of all, figuring out what exactly do I have to know and do and when, and then somehow organizing that and keeping on top of it, I think is probably the key thing that you have to come into the job with. And also, luckily for you, I think you're coming into a position in a town where we all work together fairly well. We're losing our current town administrator for other reasons that have nothing to do really with Whately per se. He just lived 15 minutes away. It's a long commute, he's a young family, yada yada. But also, he did come into a situation where there were a lot of issues that needed constant attention and longer hours than maybe he anticipated, and learning about individuals and characters and what to expect. So there's a lot of that in your future, should you walk in the door here as our new town administrator. And it's a lot on your plate. I have a great deal of respect for politicians, not just because I am one, but because there's so many balls to be juggling all the time and people to know and to communicate with. It's a very exciting, dynamic, and sometimes exhausting position. And town administrator is not much different than that. You have to respond to the needs of anybody who walks in that door, whoever they are, and be civil, if not actually, you know, delighted to see them, and be able to relay their concerns to us and the appropriate people to deal with, whether it's the police or the roads or finance or whatever.
So it's an exciting position, actually. Very young, I may not feel that way, but if you want to add to.
Well, and just to kind of throw in, Mark has the office very well organized. So he has it organized in terms of the ongoing projects and explanations in the files. And we kind of have an idea where everything is in the office, so he does have it organized. But like, for example, when I came in yesterday, I was looking for one thing in the office, got a phone call, had to do a complete left turn because there was an issue at the senior housing in town. Had to get them the information they need and then come back. So it is, like they refer to, multiple balls you're juggling at any one time. And just learning how to juggle them and to take care of the immediate need and then move on back to what you were working on.
I'd say it's kind of remarkable how much is involved in a small town. And it's not much different for 1,600 people or 16,000 or 1.6 million. You have the same issues.
I think one of the challenges, not only managing priorities, is being aware of time schedules. We have certain times of the year where certain things need to be done, and you've got three committees wanting you to do something right away to meet that schedule. So it's kind of juggling, establishing priorities, managing your workload to make sure all these things get done for the time schedules, for public meetings, for taking votes, for coordinating with other agencies, things like that, that sometimes a town administrator can't change. They're not arbitrary meetings very often. They're kind of set on a schedule because you need so much time between each activity to progress to the end product. So that, I think, is a challenge trying to manage, coordinate, and do all of that at the same time.
Mira, can you tell him of any benefits to the job?
I think, like you kind of said, it is rewarding in that you've got multiple things and it's a different day each day. I mean, I have certain tasks that are always the same, but you will get a phone call or something will come across your plate, you got to deal with it and you go back, like I said. So it's just, that's the rewarding part, is it's no day is the same.
You will never be bored.
Right.
But lonely, perhaps, but never bored.
But if I can add to Fred, I mean, with the schedules, I mean, that's where I can be a resource to the position, because I have been in this business now for 14 years. So, I mean, it's not like you're get thrown out there and you're going to have to say, I mean, if you use myself and Lynn as a resource, and you can easily get up to speed on those types of things.
With that being said, unless you got something real pressing, I'm going to thank you for coming in, and I am going to wish you good luck, and I'm going to close the interview.
Thanks, Charles.
Thank you very much, Charles.
A pleasure to meet you.
Yeah.
Charles, don't fall off any cliffs.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Welcome to town government.
Yeah.
We're ready? Okay. So, my guess is that you're Brian.
I am, yes.
Okay. My name is, as this says, I'm not sure why we have these, but we do. My name is Jonathan Edwards. I am the chair of the select board. You guys want to introduce yourself?
I'm Fred Orlowski, member of the board.
Hi.
I'm Paul Newland. I'm vice chair of the select board.
Soon to be chair. We do it on a rotating basis.
Rotating basis, yeah.
With my mayor.
We keep politics out. Thank you for coming in.
Yeah, absolutely.
Appreciate your interest in what we're doing, and appreciate the time you're giving today. We are, as you know, looking for a town administrator for the town of Whately. This person is replacing a very effective past town administrator who moved on for a variety of reasons, who is here just north of a year and a half, and he will be missed, who dealt with a lot of issues that had never cropped up in Whately before, but landed at his desk day one. So don't ask what happens day one, because
never know.
Prior to that, we had a town administrator for neighborhood of 8.5, 9.5 years, I might forget what it was, but I hadn't been here more than a year before she came on board, and she was a town clerk, and she had been the administrative assistant before that, so there's a lot of experience here. That gives you the background on Whately. We'd like to have an interview that is a discussion style interview rather than us sitting here asking you questions, you answering them, and then, you know, if there's dialogue to be had from the questions, let's have it.
Yep.
So I'm going to start the way I start all interviews. Why are you here? What brings you to Whately?
I think there's a couple of reasons. I really like working in local government. Right now I'm working at the Berkshire Regional Planning Commission. You guys probably saw that.
Yep.
I really enjoy the work there. It's quite a haul from my house. It's about an hour and 10 minutes. So I'm trying to stay somewhere in the valley. And I really like working in municipal government. And one of the other aspects of my current job that I would change if I could is the ability to work in a single municipality. Right now, we're all over the county. The way that their commission's set up is we follow the money, essentially. If there's money to work with X town, we go and work in X town and we do that discrete project. And you know, there's no continuity in your work. So I really like to focus my efforts on one place. So that's why I think town administrator role might be something good. I had conversations with the Dalton town manager about my career and my career goals and those types of things. And he said town administrator in a small community would probably be, you know, what you're looking for. He said they wear lots of hats, you get a lot of great experience, but you know, lots of different things because there's not a ton of staff people to spread the load around.
But what about Whately appeals to you? Other than the fact that it's an open job.
Yep.
What about Whately appeals to you?
I like the small community feel. I grew up in Southampton. It was like Whately is now, it's grown tremendously because of its location, Springfield, and those types of things.
Yeah.
This is the kind of town I grew up in. It's what I like the community feel of it.
Okay.
What made you switch careers from being an attorney to a regional planner?
When I was in law school, I was a law clerk at a private practice for almost 2 years. And I realized that I didn't really care much for private practice. And I do a lot of land use. We're doing land use on working with municipalities. So I saw that side of it as well. And I really just became interested in the municipal aspect of it. The municipal aspect of how it started was the land use work, the planning board work, the permitting aspects, those types of things. And when I graduated law school, I moved back to Western Mass to raise a family, and I was looking around for different government opportunities, and I landed at the Berkshire Regional Planning Commission, and I've been there for about 6-7 years now.
No plans to go back into law?
No. A lot of the work that I do there has a legal background to it.
Sure.
I mean, as you guys know, much of municipal governments run national law and on regulations and those types of things. So. There's definitely an aspect of what I'm doing that's still legally related, you know, it still has legal connotations to it, but the private practice aspect of it, I learned really young that, well, young adult, that it probably wasn't right for me. Not something I really enjoyed, so.
I'm still thinking.
I'll jump in then. What do you think happens based upon any knowledge you may or may not have about issues that are confronting Whately currently? What do you think happens in Whately on a daily basis for the town administrator?
I suspect on a daily basis, we run the daily affairs of the town. I imagine there'd be interactions with citizens who want to come in and talk. And I mean, there's issues of really the projects that are going on. If there's procurement to be had, I'm sure the town administrator does those types of things. And then depending on where you are in the year, there's various things that come up. There's the budgeting for the town. I'm sure that starts Some towns started in the fall, I believe, the previous fall. So there's those types of things. And I'm sure there's a lot of problem solving, you know, addressing issues that come up that I think you alluded to earlier, that we don't necessarily know what they are, but we need to be ready to jump on them when they come up.
Have you ever managed or supervised other employees?
I have on some of the projects that I've worked on.
Within what, Berkshire Planning Commission?
Yeah, we did a 2-year study to assess the feasibility to bring passenger rail service from New York City to Berkshire County to Pittsfield. And I was the project manager for that, and there were two staff that were working for me.
How did that come out?
Well, we think it's a possibility. There's obviously questions of financing, and there's some significant barriers in terms of track condition, and it requires the state of Connecticut to get on board, which they have many other commitments, rail commitments down closer to Fairfield County and closer to New York City. So there are some barriers, but the rail corridor is in place. The track is about 100 years old, so it can't support passenger service. There need to be significant investment in the rail corridor by both states in order to have that. The Housatonic Railroad is the railroad that owns that, or they used to own it, MassDOT, purchased it last year. They own the rights to do the freight on that railway. But there's a lot of work that still needs to be done. They had an economic study that showed that it would be a great benefit to the county, but it'll take a lot of public money to get that rail corridor up to snuff.
Yep.
So, first of all, to allay maybe some concerns over the fact that we're looking for a town administrator, and our former administrator just left after how many months?
Year and a half.
I don't want you to get the wrong impression. He left for the reason that you're applying. He said backwards. He had a long commute to get here, and he got a job, a good job, 15 minutes from his home. So, you know, it wasn't like Whately some sort of snake bit of political intrigue, and, you know, your job is going to be, people are going to be sniping at you every day. Only occasionally they might. But you're actually in a very supportive environment here administratively, and you're also, you have resources in Mary Ellen and Lynn Sibley, tremendous resources to draw from to get you up to speed in the sort of daily responsibilities and how to handle certain individuals, perhaps, or situations from their institutional memory, which will be of great service to anybody who takes this job. So my question has to do with the job itself, which, as I understand it, is being able to juggle a lot of balls at once. Not to get too bent out of shape if one or two of them drop, but to be able to get them back in circulation quickly and effectively. To deal with people who may be disgruntled about the way you're juggling things. And also to keep in mind a sense of priorities and what needs to be done when and how. And to be able to shepherd that process to an effective and efficient outcome. So my question is, if that is, in fact, the main focus of work with town administrator, what are some of the strategies that you might employ specifically to deal with that kind of environment? Can you give me some concrete examples?
Sure. Jim, on the front page of the system, right now I have 10 projects that I'm working on.
That's all?
With the commission, that's all.
I'm kidding.
At any one time. And yeah, a lot of it's deadline driven,
yes,
to be quite honest. And this is actually the system that I use. I have it's actually a project list, it's to-do list, and it's and mostly it's deadline driven. You know, like if a meeting's scheduled, you know, this moves up to the top, and if you know, if there's a little bit of space, then you have to prioritize based on deadlines, and that's really how I've been doing it.
Yeah.
I mean, secondarily, there's some things depending on, we also think, who asks you to do, in my current job, if, you know, if my executive director asks me to do something, well, that gets bumped up because, you know, because of its position,
yeah.
As opposed to if somebody else has to do something, so. Right now, the work that I'm doing is really deadline-driven.
Yeah.
For meetings, it's, we obviously have open meeting laws, so we need to get things out 48 hours in advance and get agendas out and things like that, for people, give people time to look at stuff, so.
Well,
it's deadline-driven, really. It's,
that's reassuring, and I'm sure Fred will be reassured to hear that. So let me ask another question, if I may. That has to do with how would you what do you think your best friend would say about your personal strengths, and what do you think your harshest critic would say about your personal weaknesses?
Should we start with the good or bad first?
I don't know. The bad may be actually be good if it's not bad, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. I think my friends would say that I'm easy to get along with, and I keep an even keel. I think my worst enemy would say that I can dwell on things too much. I'll keep going over things in my mind, or I'll keep going over drafts, and at some point it becomes unproductive because you're not really getting, you're never getting the value for your time, but that's something I try to work on.
Okay. Good.
Good. Well, you're at Berkshire Planning. You're the senior planner. Do you have a supervisor?
I do. Yes.
Is that a planning in the planning office, or is it administrator or something?
There's an assistant director, who's my direct supervisor, and then there's an executive director. Was also my supervisor for the organization structure is a little weird, is a little strange. But,
right. And how and who establishes your priorities and workload then? Do you do that, or are you getting direction from your supervisor, or how's that happen?
Well, I do a lot of work through the, I don't know if you're familiar with the District Local Technical Assistance Fund, that's given from the state to the regional planning agencies. Or DLTA, and we do a solicitation each fall, especially December, and we get 20-25 applications from the various towns, and we sit down, myself, the assistant director, and executive director, and we really pick what projects we're going to work on for the year. So a lot of my time is on the DLTA projects. So we're looking at what the municipalities need, and together deciding which projects we're going to do. So it's probably, I would say it's kind of a collaborative discussion as to which projects we do.
Yeah, but your priorities on a day-to-day basis, who establishes that?
I don't receive much direction on a day-to-day basis as what should be done. Really everything is sort of deadline-driven, and I guess to answer your question, I select what I work on, you know, each day based on really deadlines and meeting dates and those types of things. But they have the overall, I mean, they have the overall say of, if they tell me something, I should do X, and I'm going to do X.
Okay. What's been your biggest accomplishment since you've been working for Berkshire?
That's a good question. One thing I did early on was depending on who you talk to, this is a good thing or a bad thing. I did the legal research for the basis of Wired West, the Wired West Cooperative. I imagine you're familiar with the Wired West Cooperative.
Sure.
You may be.
No, we've had.
For it or against it. But one of the first projects I did when I was there, and it was the DLTA program. They came to us by our steering committee, which is, you know, folks from various towns. And they asked us to help them figure out how, what organization they could form that would meet their criteria X, Y, and Z. They wanted it publicly owned. They wanted local control, publicly owned, local control. Those were the big ones. And what organization could they form within the parameters of Mass General Law? So I did the research for that, and we discovered the old municipal lighting plant statutes from, oh, it was 1910 or 9, whatever it was, the early 1800s. And there was an amendment to the to that legislation, it might have been in the 80s, that allowed municipal lighting plants to engage in telecommunications. And there was another amendment that allowed them to form cooperatives. And we looked around and we noticed that oil, gas, and electric did their own fiber optics. And there's another one. There was oil and some of the municipal lighting plants out east also did telecommunications. So that was one of the ideas we floated to them. And also to a private cooperative, nonprofit. We also looked at those types of organizations. But the research that I did and the report that I did to them served as a basis for what is now Wired West. It's a whole other discussion if you want to go in and think Wired West is in its current form is right, but that's I'm on camera right now, so you better be careful what I say. But and what NBI thinks of Wired West. But
right. So you talked about it, and I've met your executive director on a few occasions, and I don't know him well, but I know him pretty well, and obviously he's your boss.
Yes.
He comes in, as you say, and he gives you a directive, and you do it.
Yep.
You drop everything if you need to. You do it.
Did that yesterday.
Because he's your boss.
Yes.
You got three.
Yep.
And the way we're structured, it's 33.3, 33.3, and 33.3.
Yep.
What do you do if at 10 o'clock in the morning, I'm going to pick on these two just because I don't want to pick on myself.
Yeah.
Paul comes in and says, we really need to, you know, X, Y, or Z.
Yeah.
And then an hour later, Fred comes in. We really need to do X, Y, and Z. And they are completely contrary to one another. One of them may have given a better argument for why it should be done, but they're completely contrary to one another. What do you do?
Well, that's a good question. I think I would, if this is possible, I would try to get everybody. Well, you got a quorum issue. The meeting law issue, right?
I didn't say that the action item was imminent.
Yeah.
I just said that this is what we have to do.
I mean, to me, it seems like, and the work needs to be done.
No, it's not necessarily imminent.
Okay.
It's not something that has to be done that hour.
If there's the opportunity to bring the board together and discuss it, I think that would be the best approach.
Okay. I would argue it would be the only approach.
Yeah. I would say the other approach would be just to bite the bullet and work later, work longer too, if it was something that was imminent. But you said, again, you said it's not imminent. So, I mean, some days it's not 9 to 5. I think we all know that.
Right. Right. No, I guess I'm trying to get at the structure of a small town government is very different than the structure of a hierarchical organization like Berkshire Planning. How do you balance the equal weights of three people? I'm saying your own personal strengths and weaknesses. And by the way, after you answer this, I want you to get back to Paul's harshest critic part of this question. But your own strength. How do you deal with it? None of us override each other. None of us, even me as the chair.
It's a tough question, and I don't know if I could give preference to one person over the other. Again, I think I would, if there's time, I would bring the issue up to the board to resolve it. I mean, there's three, so I guess, you know, it happens in other boards. It's really, if two out of three think that's the right way, I guess that's the way I'm going.
What have you, having answered your second half of your question about the harshest critic, I don't think I heard the answer to that. What would his harshest critic say about his greatest deficiency?
He focuses
did you answer
too
it?
Narrowly
sorry.
Sometimes on yeah. one thing.
So. Oh, I'm sorry, I missed that. Okay, I apologize.
Other than working with Mass Highway, or Mass DOT on the rail flying air, what other experience have you had working with that agency and say local contractors, because we've got projects in this building that we need to address in the next year or two. What is your experience dealing with that, either as a public agency or even in private life, if you had experiences with that?
I haven't done much with MassDOT aside from the with that transportation project. We have a separate transportation department, so okay. They handle most of the issues with MassDOT. The transportation manager, who's the liaison to MassDOT, so I don't interact with them on a daily basis.
Okay, what about dealing with contractors? We're going to have, building construction remodeling here, and we had one with a protecting a water wells, dealing with environmental agencies. Had any experience in that area with that type of agencies, or private, or the public?
I've worked through the town, really through the towns, in that capacity. We did a brownfields project in town Dalton. I wrote the. I wrote a grant to an EPA for brownfields cleanup in the town of Dalton, a small garage that was polluted, and the owner left it. So the town had tax title to it, and we wrote a grant. The town took title to the property, and I wrote the RFP for the we need building. So in this instance, it was building demolition. We need to find a contractor to demolish the building. Wrote the RFP and went through the process with the downtown manager to select the contractor, and part of it, and I had to meet him out on the site at one point because he needed to do wage monitoring, those types of things. That's the only one that I could think of where there's sort of direct interaction with the contractor. I mean, in my personal life, I've had to deal with electricians and plumbers and things like that. But,
you didn't deal with contractors when you were doing the research on the rail corridor?
No. Housatonic Railroad provided the railroad expertise part of, they were part of the project.
How would you feel dealing with a contractor here, say, remodeling this building? And because we haven't decided, but we assume, well, we can't assume, well, one option is to have the town administrator deal directly with that contractor on a daily or weekly basis as he's doing work in here. You feel comfortable doing something like that, or?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I don't have an issue dealing with contractors.
Well, this building, we got other buildings in town too, we possibly will be looking at it as well. So
yeah. I mean, the expectations are to do the work within the budget. Obviously, things happen, things are unforeseen, and you just have to find the best way to deal with it.
You mentioned issues that face the town. I'm wondering, are you familiar with the issues that we've faced over the last 2-3 years?
some of the research I've done before now. One was that, well, you've moved here, so you have the other town hall, the old town hall.
Yeah.
There's some ideas about reuse of the other town hall.
Any others?
There was something about improvements at the highway garage. Was there paving to do at the highway garage, or improvements at the highway garage, I believe. Mm-hmm. Something else that I came across. I didn't see this per se, but if my experience in Berkshire County is the same as here, there's always issues with the cost of education. I don't know if that's such an issue here.
Well, we all face shrinking school age populations.
Yes.
And that's the crux of it.
Yeah, but from what I read, Whately has their own elementary school district, and the kids are regional to Frontier.
At the, when they hit seventh grade.
Seventh grade, right.
Right, you're correct.
So some of the issues in some of the towns, Cummington and, I can't think, the Worthington are trying to get out from under their commitments to regional school districts because of costs and school closings. Cummington school got closed. So they're trying to get out from under these regional school districts. And with the shrinking school age populations, it's going to be an issue that the small rural towns need to face.
I have no further questions. I would just ask Ryan if he has any questions for us.
I guess one of the questions, this is a follow-up to what I was just talking about. What are the other main priorities of the town that I didn't mention that would be good to be aware of?
Well, one's the regional ambulance service. We're trying to decide on location for that. We're doing the three towns, Whately, Sunderland, and Deerfield.
Yeah.
Right now it's coordinated as one ambulance service serving all three out of South Deerfield location.
Yep.
Which is only temporary, and they're looking for permanent housing, so we're dealing with where that housing should be.
On top of that, I think we're also dealing, it's connected to the housing, but if systems don't operate the way they were originally intended, it's not just the housing, it's the sustainability of the regional service.
Yeah.
And that goes to the need. I think we're always looking at better ways to deliver services, and I think there are a lot of us who believe that regional cooperation is at the crux of that.
Yep.
And that it's critical. So always developing systems and how to get there politically is always a big deal. How do you regionalize, but how do you get people to embrace the regionalization once you present them with the package? I think that's at the heart of what we do, because everything we do is regional. And most of the things we do are regional. The schools, health district, ambulance, senior center, you name it. And that list probably should increase as opposed to decrease. So I think that's sort of a 30,000 foot level look at what we're coming up against. Community compact is something that we're going to have to pursue. Clean streets, not clean streets.
Clean streets. Yeah.
Street. Yeah. That's another issue. There are a lot of, but they should be clean too.
Absolutely. Yeah. Complete.
Those are a lot of the things, and they always crop up. Budget, as you know. So, and stuff that we don't know is going to happen yet. Economic development, as Paul alluded to. Without economic development, you know, shrinking population, our senior population will begin to pass away, unfortunately. And if we don't have replacement parts, it's going to be problematic, not just from a community. Not from a service delivery perspective, but just the community feel, the community culture, whatnot. So that's just the microcosm. Other questions?
One of my first, actually one of the first times I came to Whately, I was doing the Whately Police Triathlon.
Really?
Yeah. I used to run right by here. You guys should bring that back.
Don't we still, we do.
No, it went away.
The police do something, don't they? But recently it went away.
I think I might have done it. I did it the last year, maybe it was 2013.
I was gonna say, it's been a couple of years.
Has it been a couple of years?
Yeah. That was always fun, though.
Yeah.
It's outside, but.
No other questions? Other than that, I mean, I'm good.
Me too.
So, it's been a pleasure having you. I appreciate you coming in.
Sure, thank you.
And we'll be in touch.
Great.
Okay?
Yes, I appreciate it very much.
Great, thank you.
All right. Nice to meet you.
Thanks, Brian.
Nice to meet you.
Pleasure.
Oh, and a new seal, right?
New seal, new flag, seal.
Was it true you drove to Boston?
What's that?
Was it true you drove to Boston?
Boston, too.
Did you drop the flag off in Boston? Wasn't that in the recorder?
I was supposed to, but there's gonna be an event instead.
Oh, good.
Senator Rosenberg's driving.
Gotcha.
Have a great rest of your day.
All right, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Okay.